Amen. You know, I love that song. And I think mainly just because of the declaration that it makes, that I'm just going to praise you. I'm going to praise you on the mountains. I'm going to praise you in the valley just the same. I love that declaration because that's the challenge. You know, and we all agree, isn't it easier to worship God on the mountains? You know, unless it's raining. But other than that, when you're on the mountains and you feel the brisk wind coming across your face and you're able to see the view of the horizon and you just see like the capacity of how incredible God is compared to those moments when you find yourself in the valley. And when you're in the valley, the only thing that you see around you are hills and mountains that have to be climbed. And the only thing that you see sometimes is maybe water rushing down the mountains or maybe rocks rolling down the mountains. And it's hard to see sometimes past what you see in the valley, depending upon how lush the vegetation is and where you find yourself at and the level of forestation that you are. Sometimes it's difficult just to be able to see just exactly what's in front of you. And the question is, can we praise God in those moments? Can we praise him then? That's the real test of our faith. And that's what we've been doing in this series is we've been looking at how do we continue to have faith when we find ourselves in those moments when we are on the dark side of faith, when we're facing the impossibilities, when we're facing the difficulties, when we're facing those questions that will cause us to maybe doubt what it is that we believe, doubt who God is, questions that we've been asking like, God, why did you let it happen? Why is there suffering and evil in the world? We've dealt with that. Why would a loving God allow hell to exist? We've talked about that. And then we also talked about just this idea of why, God, didn't you answer my prayer? It seems like I've been praying and praying and praying, but it seems like you just don't hear. What do we do in those moments? How do we process our faith? How do we continue to press on in what it is that I believe? Because maybe what we do is we go through these kind of circumstances and you're thinking, well, Ken, this is great, but let me tell you, Ken, my trust in God is shaken. It's just shaken. And so the question is, well, if it is shaken, then how do I get to a place where I can begin to rebuild where it is that I find myself? How can I begin to grow in that? And there's some truth that I think is important for us to understand. And we've talked about this over the course of the series, and I will continue to emphasize this, is that just because you have faith, just because you belong to Jesus, just because you're committed to living this life, just because you're committed to prayer, does not mean that everything in your life is going to work out. And especially the way that you exactly want it to. It just doesn't mean that. So, and I think sometimes we have that misnomer. We have this, like, I've been praying, God, why isn't this working out? Because, again, as we said last week, faith is not a guarantee that a miracle will happen. Having faith is not a guarantee that a miracle will happen. However, not having faith is a guarantee that it won't. So that's what we kind of looked at last week. And so I wanted to dig into this aspect of trust and how do we build this trust? How do we, if we want to begin to reestablish our relationship with him? Because as we look at the dark side of faith and processing that, again, one of the things that I love about Scripture is that it does not hold back the struggles and wrestles of some of its main characters so that we can look at what they go through as well. Because as a believer, it is true that, again, even though I believe in Jesus and who he is, I will suffer loss. I will. I will suffer some kind of loss. So the question becomes, well, how do I process that? You know, there's a guy in the Bible that God himself says to this guy, hey, you know what, David, you're a guy after my own heart. You're a guy after my own heart, is what God says about him. And even in that, we see that he suffers loss. For example, it says in 2 Samuel chapter 12, verses 16 to 17, David begged God to spare the child. So David finds out his wife, he had an affair, and then she got pregnant. And so he finds out that they're going to have they have a child, and he finds out that the child is sick, and there's a strong possibility that the child is going to die. So David begged God to spare the child. He went without food and lay all night on the bare ground. The elders of his household pleaded with him to get up and eat with them, but he refused. And I'm going to tell you, as a parent, and for those, because I see some people in this room, and I know there's some people in our nursery next door, that you have kids that are young. And one of the toughest things when you have kids that are young is when they're sick. Because it's not like they could say, my stomach doesn't feel well, I can't breathe. Like you just have to basically private detective your way to figure out what's going on in your child. And there is nothing that makes you feel more helpless than when your child is sick. Nothing, because you can try to figure it all out. And even when you have children that can speak, sometimes depending upon what it is that you're going through as a parent, there's nothing that makes you feel more helpless than when your child is sick. And so David is in this place, and he's going before God, and he's begging God, like, please, please save the life of my child. But then tragedy does end up striking. And it goes on to say, in 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 18, then on the seventh day, the child died. David's advisors were afraid to tell him. He wouldn't listen to reason while the child was ill, they said. What drastic thing will he do when we tell him the child is dead? So how is he going to respond when tragedy hits? How is he going to handle this? Because I looked at how he handled it when the child was sick, and we could barely reason with him to be able to take care of himself. Now, it's worse. The child has passed away. How is he going to handle that? And so he goes on, and it says in verses 19 through 20, when David saw them whispering, he realized what had happened. Is the child dead? He asked. Yes, they replied. He is dead. Then David got up from the ground, washed himself, put on lotions, and changed his clothes. He went to the tabernacle and worshiped the Lord. After that, he returned to the palace and was served food and ate. Wait. It seems like you're grieving before the child passes away. And now that the child has passed away, you're like getting up and cleaning yourself and eating, and you're getting, like, his response to the situation just completely blew their minds, because they were expecting something completely and wholly opposite than that. And so basically asked them, like, how can you do that? Like, how can you react in this way? And here's what he says in verses 22 and 23. It says, David replied, I fasted and wept while the child was alive. For I said, perhaps the Lord will be gracious to me and let the child live. But why should I fast when he is dead? Can I bring him back again? And will I go? I will go to him one day, but he cannot return to me. And so David completely looks at it from an optimistic perspective. Like, it's time to move on. The child has passed away. It's time to move on from this loss. Now, I want to make this really clear. This is not a message where I tell you, just get over it, move on. That's not the point where I'm saying. That's just how David responded. How we respond to grief and mourning and those kind of, how do we respond to that? That's up to us as individuals. So I want to make that really clear. That's not what I'm saying here. But what I'm saying is, as we look at David's response, that's just how he processed his loss. That's how he dealt with it. And he was ready to move on. But let me tell you this. It's not like David didn't wrestle again. He went through other issues. He went through other challenges in his life and was trying to figure out, God, how does this work out? How are we going to get through this? God, I feel so distant from you. I'm wrestling in my relationship with you. And the great thing is, David gives this prayer. And if you've been listening to the podcast, I actually talked about this in the podcast a couple weeks ago. And we're going to read that same passage again. But we're going to look at it a little bit differently in the message today. Because what this passage does is it gives us some really good insight on if you're at that place where your trust in God has been broken. And you realize that, and you're thinking, you know what, I want to see that trust restored. I want to renew my relationship with God once again. I want to renew that trust once again. But Ken, how do I rebuild that? And so that's what we're going to look at for the rest of this message. And the first step that is so vitally important if you're going to rebuild your trust is to be honest about your doubts. Be honest about your questions. Be honest about your wrestles. I love how David put it in Psalm chapter 13, verses 1 and 2. It said, "Oh Lord, how long will you forget me? Forever? How long will you look the other way? How long must I struggle with anguish in my soul, with sorrow in my heart every day? How long will my enemy have the upper hand? How long? How long?" And I mentioned this before, but I want to mention this again. A lot of times when we think of faith as answers. And the more answers that I have, the stronger my faith is. I think it's the exact opposite. It's the exact opposite. I think the more questions you have, the stronger your faith is. Now, you may be looking at it and going, wait, Ken, it doesn't make sense of what I've been told. But when you look at it this way, and we'll dig into this in a second, just think about it. I believe, and this is a statement, I want to encourage you to write this down, that we're closer to God when we're asking questions than when we think we have all the answers. We're closer to God when we're asking questions than when we think we have all the answers. How many of you have dealt with the know-it-all? Raise your hand. Have you dealt with the know-it-all? Some of you are like, here's the thing. What is it that is so difficult about dealing with the know-it-all? They know it all. Exactly. Perfect. The thing that makes it difficult with dealing with someone who's a know-it-all is that they know it all. So can you tell a know-it-all anything? Is a know-it-all asking questions? Is a know-it-all seeking answers? Is a know-it-all seeking insight? Is a know-it-all seeking growth? So I think, based upon that, I think we are actually closer to God when we're asking questions than when we have the answers. Because of this one reason, it says this in Luke chapter 19, in chapter 11, verses 9 and 10. It says, "So I tell you, keep on asking, and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking, and you will find. Keep on knocking, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. Everyone who seeks finds. And to everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. So I tell you, seek." How do you seek? You ask questions. That's the position of someone who's a seeker. So we will never seek God if we think we know it all. At least get to the point where you know it some, because maybe you can figure out the rest. But it's even better if we get to a point where I can admit, God, I don't know anything. I don't know anything. I think, and you know, isn't that what life does? As soon as you think you have life figured out, I have dotted the I's of life, I have crossed the T's of life, I have even fixed the lowercase j's of life. Like, I got life figured out, and life goes, okay. All right. Game on. Game on. And life will remind you that as much as you think you have it all figured out, you don't. And so the challenge is to get to this place where we are committed to being a seeker, because that's when we grow. We grow the most when we are facing trials. We grow the most when we are facing adversity. We grow the most when we are facing struggles. And I know that when we are in the middle of it, we say, God, I have such a difficult time trusting you. And this is so hard, and this is so impossible. That's real faith. That's real faith in the midst of the struggle, in the midst of the impossible. That's real faith. Real faith is, again, when you're saying, God, I don't have all the answers. I'm frustrated. I'm angry. I'm disappointed. I'm wrestling. I'm ticked off. When you're able to say those things with God, God is able to say, all right, now you're ready to receive. It's like the person who's drowning. When someone is drowning, do you try to rescue them when they're trying to save themselves? No, because what will happen? They'll pull you under right along with them. So when someone is drowning, you wait until they've decided, I can't swim. And then they're really seeking answers. For those of us who think we know it all or we have it all figured out, what we're trying to do in the middle of a situation when we're drowning is we are trying to rescue ourselves. And that's just setting us up for more failure. So that's why we are never closer to God than when we are asking questions rather than having all the answers. So if you're wondering why, ask God why. If you're struggling, tell God that you're struggling. If you want to figure out what to do, ask God for wisdom. If you're wrestling through those things, ask God for it. He invites you to it. And let me tell you this, and this is a good one to write down as well. God would rather that you run to him with your questions than run from him with your doubts. Let me say that again. God would rather that you run to him with your questions than run from him with your doubts. So pursue him, grow in him. So that's the first step. The first step is to admit, God, I'm wrestling, I'm struggling, I have my doubts. Be honest with yourself. You can never begin to restore your trust as long as you are living in denial. So be honest with yourself. And then that brings us to the second step is pray. Talk to God about it. Talk to God about it. I love what David does here in Psalm chapter 13, verses 3 and 4. He says, turn to me and answer me, O Lord my God. Restore the sparkle to my eyes, or I will die. Let my enemy gloat. Don't let my enemies gloat, sorry, saying we have defeated him. Don't let them rejoice over my downfall. So what does David do? Is David expresses like, okay, God, here are my doubts, but here's what I'm asking. Here's what I'm asking. And did you notice what he does and what he's asking is he's very specific in what he's asking. Don't let my enemies gloat over me. Don't let them rejoice in my downfall. That's something that's specific. Why is it important to be specific in your prayers? Let me tell you, the more specific you are in your prayers, the easier it will be to recognize when God is at work. The more specific you are in your prayers, the easier it is to recognize when God is at work. And I've shared the story with you guys, but I just want to share it again. When I was trying to decide to start a church, I had someone that came to me and said, Ken, I think you should start a church. I think you would do a great job. And so I started praying about it, and I was like, I feel like this might be something that God, that you want me to do. But here's two things. These are two caveats. If you really want me to take the step and to try this, I need more confirmation. Because I want to make sure this isn't just me and just my pride and my own arrogance. I need more confirmation. And the second thing is the church that I was on staff that was struggling financially. So I said, God, in order for me to feel comfortable moving on, I need to know that this church is going to be okay. So those are my two things. If this is what you want me to do, these are the two things I need to see happen. And the interesting thing is, and I didn't tell anyone other than Heidi. Heidi was the only one that knew that this was something I was trying to process and wrestle with and trying to figure out. And I had multiple people on different occasions say to me, hey, if you started a church, I think you'd do a good job. Multiple people tell me that. So then I was like, okay, God, maybe this is what you want me to do. And then all of a sudden, a door opened at my old church where we were able to be in a place where now we were okay financially. And I thought, okay, God, that's it. So the more specific you are in your prayers, the easier it is to recognize when God is at work, when God is moving. I love what it says. There's an instance that Jesus has. Jesus is walking through this town, and as he's walking through this town, there's these guys who are blind that hears that he's walking through town. And so they begin to yell, and it says in Matthew chapter 20, verse 30, he says, two blind men were sitting beside the road. When they heard that Jesus was coming that way, they began shouting, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. So you know what that is? That's just a general cry. Have mercy on me. Does that really say anything? It just says, I need you. But does it really say what I need? Have mercy on us. And I think sometimes what we do in our prayers that makes it so difficult for us to recognize when God is at work is we pray things like, God, build my faith. Or God, give me patience. Or God, give me strength. Now, there's nothing wrong with those prayers, but how do you know when he does it? Because those are general prayers that are not very specific for you to be able to recognize when God is at work. So Jesus walks over, and it says in Matthew chapter 20, verses 33 and 34, Lord, they said, because he asked them, okay, well, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? And it says, Lord, they said, we want to see. Jesus felt sorry for them and touched their eyes. Instantly, they could see. Then they followed him. So you know what happened? They were specific. We want to see. Then boom, they got their prayer, and they got their answer, and guess what? They could see. So what I want to encourage you to do is to be more specific in your prayer. So rather than say, God, give me strength, you maybe want to say something like, God, I'm looking at my job, and I am dealing with people who are really difficult. And you may even be able to name the difficult person that you're dealing with. God, you know how much they work my nerve. And God, and notice I said nerve, not nerves, because they're on your last one. So God, you know how much they work my nerve. So God, I pray that you would give me kind words to be able to say that communicate what it is that I feel, but also deal with the issue. You see how specific that is? So then when that happens, you know that God's giving you the capacity to be able to do that. God, give me faith. That's wonderful. But what if you said something like this? God, right now my family is struggling financially, and we are $1,300 below what we owe for rent. So God, I pray that you would give us that $1,300 to be able to cover our rent. So you know what happens? Because you're that specific, when it happens, guess what? You know that he answered it. So the more specific you are in your prayer, the easier it is for you to recognize when God is at work. I think that's one of the reasons why we have a difficult time being able to recognize it. It's just because we pray all these general prayers, and then we think God's not working, but our prayers are so general that it's hard for us to recognize that he's at work. So those are the first two. The first one, be honest about your doubts, your questions. The second one is pray and be specific in your prayers exactly about what it is that you need. And then the third thing that helps you build your faith is, or build your trust, is surrender. It's surrender. Now let me tell you, of the three, that's the most difficult one. Because here's what we love to do. And let's be honest. God, hear my questions. God, hear my prayer needs, and then control. We want to control and manipulate and work. And I'm not saying that we should just sit back and take a laissez-faire approach to life and do nothing. I'm not saying that either. But what I'm saying is what we need to do is surrender to be able to say, you know what, God, your will be done. You ultimately do what is best, and I will trust you to do that. It says in Psalm chapter 13, verses 5 and 6, it says, but I trust in your unfailing love. I will rejoice because you have rescued me. I will sing to the Lord because he is good to me. Now, do you notice the kind of wording that he's using? Even in the midst of this, I'm struggling, here's what I need, but God, you're good to me. You know what he's doing? It's trust. He's surrendering in that moment. He's handing things over to God. And let me give you this. Surrender means that you choose to trust God even when you don't understand. Surrender means that you choose to trust God even when you don't understand. And I would maybe even say, especially when you don't understand. I am choosing to trust in you. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, maybe one that many of us are familiar with. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Trust. The Hebrew word for trust there is botok. Not botox, botok. Although it's really close, isn't it? But botok. I know that's the way my mind works. But it literally means like dependence on, reliance on. And we'll talk about how valuable that word is in a minute. But trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not depend on your own what? Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Do not lean on your own understanding. Why not? Because here's the truth, your own understanding is flawed. It's flawed. You think you see it. You think you have it all figured out, but there are things that you don't see. There are things that you don't know. There are things that you haven't figured out. There are things coming around the corner that you have no idea what it might be. Don't lean on your own understanding. Because many times our own understanding is wrong. It's wrong. Or it's faulty. Or it's just not enough. There's not enough information because we don't know the future. All we see is what's in front of us, and we come to an understanding of what's in front of us, but our understanding is inaccurate. It's inaccurate. I love spy movies. I love like the James Bond movies. I love, you know, the Ethan Hawke movie, or Ethan Hunt, sorry. I love those movies. There's books that I'm listening to. I love the Jason Bourne series. Like, I love those kind of movies. And have you ever seen it where they're trying to like infiltrate, they're trying to work their way into a place, but they can't see around the corners. And so what they do is they have a hacker. And so the hacker has hacked his way into all the cameras, or her way into all the cameras. And so as they're walking through, you know, the hacker will go, wait, stop, hide. And so they'll go hide, and all of a sudden you see, like, dude, you know, people walk by. And then they'll say, okay, go, the coast is clear. So then they go some more, and then the hacker will go, go into that door. And then they'll go into the door, and they'll hide, and you see people walk by. And what happens is the hacker, because they've hacked into the cameras, they're able to see who's coming. And so the hacker is able to see what the spy is not able to see. According to the spy's own understanding, the path in front of him is clear. But the hacker sees beyond the spy's understanding and sees all the obstacles coming the spy's way. And so this is the same idea of what God does for us. God is our hacker. He's our hacker. And we're going through life, and we're trying to figure out corners and turns and ways to go. And according to our own understanding, if we follow our own understanding, we're going to walk right into a trap. And so God says, look, no. This is the direction that I desire for you to go in. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Acknowledge him in all your ways, and he will direct your path. He will direct your path. So again, trust in him. Trust in him. Like, your trust is only as strong as the object by what you put your trust in. Let me say it again. Your trust is only as strong as the object that you put your trust in. That's why I love what it says in Psalm chapter 20, verses 7 and 8. Some nations boast of their chariots and horses, but we boast in the name of the Lord our God. Those nations will fall down and collapse, but we will rise up and stand firm. Why? Because of what it is that we put our trust in, because of where we found it, because of where we're located. I had an opportunity a couple weeks ago to do a wedding in Santa Barbara. And so I took my oldest daughter with me. And so she stayed with me in Santa Barbara. We had a lot of fun that weekend. But one of the things we were doing is we had time to kill before the wedding started, before I had to be there at the wedding. So we went to this place called the Goleta State Beach. And they have a pier on the beach. And as you walk across this beach, as you walk across this pier, all the wood is like, it's this old wood planking. And some of the wood, there's one point I stepped on the wood and realized, like, am I fat? Because the wood went wonk. It's like, you know, and there's nothing that makes you feel that fat than when you step on thick wood, it goes wonk, you know. But you look at it, and so I look, and as you're walking, between each plank, there's like a little gap in between. So you see like air, ocean. And you're seeing how high you are up off the ocean. And you can look at some of the planks, and some of the planks have been replaced. And you can look at some of the planks, they look warped. And so we're walking on this thing, and I didn't feel very secure at all. I didn't. But we made it to the end, and you can say, praise God, by the grace of him, we made it back. But I can tell you, man, I was praying, God, please let this thing hold up. I got to do this wedding, you know, kind of thing. Now, compare that to going to Manhattan Beach Pier. If you go to Manhattan Beach Pier, it's concrete. The whole pier is concrete. There's no gaps. It's all concrete. So you don't even question your steps because you know that it can hold you. So here's the idea that you have to look at is, where is your trust? Do you have a Goleta Beach type of trust in God? Or do you have the Manhattan Beach Pier type of trust in God? Where is your level of trust at that you have in him? And let me tell you, the greatest test of that trust, the greatest builder of that trust, is surrender. It's surrender. I was talking to a guy once who was in an accident, and he said, What happened is the car started to spin out of control, and I tried to fix the car, and then it started hooking the other way. So I tried to fix the car, and it started hooking the other way. And he said at one point, he just let go of the steering wheel. Control, surrender. So which is it that you're trying to do in your life? Control or surrender? That's the element that you have to look at. And what happens is when you are able to be honest with God about your doubts, be specific with God about your prayers, and then surrender, then with surrender, you get a chance to be able to watch what God can do. And again, when I say surrender, surrender does not mean not to do anything. Like, God, I pray that you give me a job. I'm waiting. I pray for it. Because sometimes, isn't that what we do with our prayers? Is God, I'm handing my marriage over to you and praying, God, that you fix my marriage. And we do nothing. That's not surrender. That's laziness. So what surrender is, okay, God, I'm praying for a job. I'm going to go out. I'm going to fill out applications. And wherever I end up, God, I'm trusting you to lead me there to where you want me to be. God, in my marriage, I can't control what my wife does. I can't control what my husband does. So, God, I surrender them to you. But in the meantime, God, I'm going to work on me to be the best version of me that I can be. That's surrender. So I want to make sure that we don't get those two confused. Because sometimes we think surrender means do nothing. No, that's not what it means. What it means is, God, I will do what it is that I know to do, but ultimately I will leave the results up to you. Even if what I know to do may be uncomfortable. Because surrender may mean confession of sin. Surrender may mean asking for forgiveness. Surrender may mean humbling yourself. Surrendering may mean, so we could go through that and we could look at some steps. Surrendering may mean us taking some painful steps that we really don't want to take, but that's surrender. That's surrender. So God, I yield to you. I'm going to do the uncomfortable stuff, and God, I will trust you to handle the rest. So with that, this is my last insight that I wanted to share with you. Trust doesn't mean you always get what you want, right? Because is that you can't always get what you want. That's right. And I know that was horrible. Sorry about that. You're like, what pitch is that? That's a horrible pitch. That's what it is. Trusting God means that no matter what happens, you believe God will do what is best. Trusting God means no matter what happens, you believe that God will do what is best. That's surrender. That's surrender. And here's the thing, and as we wrap up, I just wanted to say this, that on the other side of surrender and on the other side of loss, and I've talked about this a couple weeks ago, so I'm not going to spend too much time on it, but I just want to go back to David. David has this child that passes away. And so David gets up, he starts to eat, he cleans himself up, and then the scriptures say that he goes to then she became his wife, he goes to her, and he comforts her in her loss. And then it says she got pregnant again. And the next child that she gave birth to was Solomon. And Solomon would go on to become the next king of Israel. So the thing is, when we surrender and we go through loss, we never know what our resurrections may be. We never know what our Solomons may be. We never know what God can do, what God can do the most incredible things out of loss. He really can, and that's when we need to trust in him. Father, I just thank you so much this morning, and I just pray that you have used this morning to speak to someone who's here, who's wrestling, who's struggling, who's trying to figure things out. And I pray that maybe this message has given them some insight about trust in you and what that trust means, and really beginning to express that dependency, that trust in you, that desire to seek you. I pray that we have the kind of relationship with you, God, that we can be honest with our doubts and know that you welcome us in our doubts to bring them to you. That you're okay with that. Again, that you're a big boy and that you can handle our doubts. But Father, also, I pray that we learn to be specific in our prayers. And that in the specificity, that we are able to see exactly what it is that you are at work and that you are doing. And God, also, I just want to take this moment to just pray for surrender. That's probably one of the most difficult elements of this, is surrender and yield. To get to a point where we say, not my will, but your will be done. You move, Father, as you desire to move. And all these things we ask in your name. Amen.